Good morning. How you guys doing today? Good? How about the weather? Pretty, where on earth do we live? Like it's snowing last week, then it's 80, and then it's snowing again, 5-8 inches. Oh, Lord bless us. Man. How crazy. Well, it is so good to be with you in church this morning and opening up God's word. And we are going through the series Satisfied, which is our study through the book of Colossians. And today we're going to be in chapter 3, and we're going to be going through verses 15 through 17. And while you're turning there, I want to share something in church today. I want to confess something to you, and that is that I am terrible at fashion. Okay? Terrible. My wife has been giving me fashion advice since we've been married, and when I say that, what I really mean is that she's been dressing me, and she would probably deny that because, especially today, because I dressed myself and probably look awful, and I always go back to those same awful patterns of dressing without her guidance. And so, just to give you a really stark comparison, before I was married to my wife, I dressed like that. I'm the one in the middle telling the story with my hands. Of course. And you will notice the shaggy hair on top, surfer look, pretty popular back in the early 2000s. And then, of course, a top that was free, a jacket or a shirt that I got free from a sport almost always. Those are the only shirts that I had. And yes, you are seeing that correctly. That is a belt buckle. That's a story for another time, all right? And then, of course, my favorite Wrangler bootcut jeans. And at the bottom, some worn-out Adidas shoes, sometimes supplemented with cowboy boots, just to keep it fresh. Needless to say, my wife has done a miracle. She's done a miracle, and she continues to do so. Because without her guidance, I fall back into those same dressing habits. And one of the things that my wife has taught me, or really tried to teach me, is this thing that the rest of you probably already know. I see many of you doing it right now. It's called layering, right? Who knows what layering is? Yeah. So it's it's when you layer different types of clothes on top of each other, and it kind of brings the outfit all together. You got the shirt and then the overshirt, and you're layering things on top of each other. It's like a technique, you know? And if you didn't know that, you're welcome. Not only are you going to receive a biblical message today, but also some pretty on-point fashion tips as well. So, bet you didn't know that was happening this morning. One of the most important things, though, that almost always gets forgotten in this layering process is the jacket, okay? Everyone does good with the clothes, but then they forget about the jacket. And the jacket is the thing that goes over top of all of it. It kind of brings the whole thing together. And you're probably thinking right now, Pastor Tommy, what is the point of this? It's because this morning we are going to be talking about the jacket. Now, I'm going to take this one off because I am a sweaty person, and this is unhelpful to me. But we're going to be talking about the jacket, not this jacket specifically. We're going to be talking about the jacket of the passage that we're in today. And if you've noticed, as we've been going through Colossians chapter 3, there's been this theme that has been present through the entire thing, and it's this theme of clothing or garments. Have you seen it as we've been going through this as a church? The new believer, when they become new in Christ, they put off the old, they throw away the old garments, and they put on the new garments of the new man, the new creation in Jesus Christ to represent their new life. They put on Christ's likeness and forgiveness and love. That's in verses 12 through 14. And then we get to verse 15. And verses 15 through 17 is the jacket or the outer coat or the robe that goes on top of everything else. That's what we're looking at today in Colossians 3. And that leads us to the title of the message today, which is Putting on Christ, Part 2. Because we are not done putting things on for Christ. So Colossians chapter 3, verse 15. If you're looking at your Bibles, look with me at verse 15 and let's read it together. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your heart to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Let's pray this morning. God, we are so thankful for your word. Pray right now that you would speak to our hearts from your word. The truth of your word would be realized in our minds and in our hearts and move us to action this morning. The truth of your word is so beautiful and so instructive. And so God, help us understand. Help us to go through this. Be with us in our time together this morning, worshiping you through the reading and teaching of your word, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So let's start with the first verse, right? Verse 15. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Here's the first thing that we're going to see in the passage is we need to be governed by the peace of Christ. We need to be governed by the peace of Christ. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. So let's start with the first word. What's the first word in that verse? You say it? No, before let. And is the first word. And is the first word. We're going to start with and. And you're probably thinking, well, that's a pretty common word. Like, Pastor Tommy, why are we stopping at and? I mean, what's a big deal about the word and? It's very common. And I agree with you. But the amazing thing and the thing that I love about God's word is that every word is important. Did you know that? Every single word. I love that. It's so beautiful, isn't it? That every word was breathed out by God with importance and intention. There is not a single word in Scripture that is wasted, not even the and. I was studying with a friend this week, and he was reading through this old English prayer book, and he turned to me and he goes, "Man, what does erstwhile mean?" I'm like, dude, I have no idea. I've never heard that word in my entire life. I don't know what erstwhile means. I mean, that's a pretty complicated word. I'm sitting over here and I'm trying to figure out what the word and means, all right? And you're asking me this crazy, I know what the word and means. I'm gonna tell you, it's in this context, it means that this isn't a new theme. This isn't a new idea. This isn't a new line of thinking. This is a continuation of the previously developed theme that we went through before in the scripture. Putting on Christ's likeness, putting on forgiveness, putting on love. It now continues, and it continues with the same imperative. You've got to get this. You need to grab hold of this. You need to do this. Don't forget this. This is all part of it. You need to do all of the things previously mentioned and these ones as well. It's a continuation of the scripture. And notice the difference between the previous verses and the ones that we are in this morning. Before it was put on, put on, put on, right? Put on Christ-likeness, put on forgiveness, put on love. Now it changes. What's the word now? You said it before. And let the peace of Christ rule. It's almost as if it's changed from this action, this active act of putting things on, and now it's an allowance or an invitation of something to take place in my life. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Let the peace of Christ rule. And the verb rule is very interesting, by the way. Maybe you didn't know this. The word rule means umpire. Did you know that? It means umpire. Let the peace of Christ be the umpire in your life. Do you have a problem with something or someone? Are you caught in the middle of something? Do you have a decision that needs to be made? Let the peace of Christ decide the outcome. The peace of Christ is the umpire of the Christian life, making decisions on our behalf. But so many times we want to be the umpire of our own lives, right? We fear that lack of control. I want to be able to control everything because that's comfortable to me and I want to make my own decisions. And so then I become the umpire of my own life and I decide what's fair and what's foul and what's in bounds and what's out of bounds. I make the decisions. It's what I want. I'm not comfortable giving control away to the Lord. It's what I want to do. I want to call the shots. I want to rule my own life because it's comfortable, because it's what I know. And I don't want to give that away to anyone else. I need the control. And so I'm going to be the umpire of my own life. We fall into this so often, don't we? We fall into this idea of I'm going to rule what I want, what I want, what I want. I'm going to control the situation. I'm going to control what goes on here. I'm going to make the ruling. I'm going to decide. And the truth is when we have that idea, when we do that, when we behave that way, when we try to be the umpires of our own lives, there is no peace. There is no peace. Maybe you've felt that for a long time. The truth is that there is only peace in Christ. It is the peace that Christ gives to us. So what is the peace of Christ? What is the peace of Christ? The meaning of the word peace can be, in this case, can be two concepts. It can be the concept of a covenant, a bond, an agreement, or another concept is tranquility, rest, or security. And I think that the peace of Christ fulfills both of these meanings. And I'll tell you why. When you turned from your sin and embraced Jesus Christ by faith for the forgiveness of your sin, and you made Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life, you made a covenant with him. You made an agreement with him. Because before that, you were an enemy to Christ. You were an enemy of Christ. Romans 5:10 says, "For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God, by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life." We were enemies to Christ. In the spiritual war, we were on two different sides. We were on the side of sin and death, and Christ was on the side of righteousness and life. And when you came to Christ, you said, "Jesus, I don't want to be an enemy of you any longer. I don't want to be your enemy. I want this war to be over." And Jesus, in his death on the cross, in his resurrection from the dead, in his ascension into heaven, wrote a contract with you. He made a treaty with you, a covenant, a bond, an agreement. He said that the war is over between you and I. We are at peace. How awesome is that? We were once enemies to the Lord Jesus Christ, and when we came to him, he wrote a covenant with us and said, "We are no longer at war. We are at peace." That's one concept. The other concept is the inner rest and tranquility and security of my own heart. That's here as well in the peace of Christ. When I make decisions, I have the peace of Christ being the umpire in my life. Will this decision bring peace in my heart? Will it bring tranquility in my heart? Will it bring rest to my soul? Will it bring the security of knowing that God is in control of everything? If I have a decision that needs to be made, I need the peace of Christ to be the umpire and say, "That's fair," or "That's foul," or "That's inbounds," or "That's out of bounds," or "You can keep going," or "Hey, it's time to stop." I need Christ to be the umpire of my life. The peace of Christ ruling in my life, in my heart. The verse goes on to say, "To which indeed you were called in one body." This simply means that every Christian is called to let the peace of Christ rule their heart. Every Christian is called to this. Because if I'm called and I let the peace of Christ rule my heart, and you're called and you let the peace of Christ rule your heart, and Christ is ruling and reigning over our hearts, and he is being the umpire of all of our decisions, then we are going to have unity together in the body of Christ to which we have been called. Then the last thing in the verse, it says, I love this, "And be thankful." And be thankful. Now we're going to skip that for now, and I promise we're going to get back to it at the end. So how do I let the peace of Christ, how do I let the peace of Christ rule in my heart? How do I allow that to take place? How do I let that happen? How do I do that? Well, I think two ways. two ways. The first is facts, the fact. It's the fact of the matter. The fact is that Jesus Christ and I are on the same side now. Jesus Christ and I are no longer at war. We are at peace and we are on the same side. And so are the decisions that I'm making, are they being consistent with that reality? Are they consistent with the reality that me and Jesus are on the same side? It's a remembering of whose side I'm on, the fact that me and Jesus are on the same side. Christ and I are at peace. And I need to live like that is true. I need to live like that is true, that we are on the same side. And so my decisions go through that fact. They go through that promise. They go through that. Does this reflect me being on Jesus' side? Or does this reflect me being against Jesus? So it's the fact, but it's also the feeling. It's also the feeling. Will this leave me with rest and tranquility in my heart? Will this leave me with rest? Or is the decision I'm about to make going to stir up chaos? Is it going to make a tempest in my heart? Is it going to give me anxiety or fear? Or is it going to give my heart rest and tranquility and security? And it's both of these together, not separate. It's together. The peace of Christ is both of these together. Understanding the fact that Jesus and I are on the same side, and that determines my decision-making, and then also the feeling of, is this going to bring rest to my soul? Is this going to bring tranquility to my heart? That's how I let the peace of Christ rule my heart. The next thing that we're going to see in the verse 16, let's read it together. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your heart. Second thing that we see is to be grounded in the word of Christ. Be grounded in the word of Christ. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Notice again, it starts with let. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. It's an invitation to allow the word of Christ to dwell. And I love the definition of the word dwell. You ready for it? It means to be at home. That's what dwell means, to be at home. The word of Christ should be at home in your life. Now, I don't know if you're like me. I'm a homebody. I love being at home. Anyone with me on that? You could raise your hand, it's cool. I just love being at home. I love it. It's comfortable. My family is there. I know like where everything is. It's like mostly peaceful. I mean, we have a 4-year-old, so you know. Mostly peaceful. It's warm. It's inviting. It's where I like to be. I love being home. But I also love vacations. Amen? Amen. I love vacations. And we don't get to take many of those as a family. I think my wife and I have been on maybe 2 vacations since we've been married. But it's nice. It's nice to get away and rest. And the beach is great. And I like swimming in the ocean. And room service is a pretty fun concept. And it's strange and new, and it's a nice change of pace. And we always say the same thing. I mean, we've only been twice, so we've said the same thing twice. And so we say the same thing every time, though, is when we get there, we look at everything and we're like, wow, this is beautiful. We should live here, right? Do you say that? I say that all the time. When we get there, I'm like, it's beautiful. Oh, my goodness. Like, it's... The sun is always shining. It's warm outside. It rains for like 10 minutes. It certainly isn't snowing in April. That's for sure. It's beautiful. I want to live here. This is great. Palm trees? Who sees that? The ocean? You can't even see the other side. It's like Lake Michigan, but like 10 times better. Love it, right? But then something happens. Towards the end of the vacation, this old familiar feeling starts to creep its way into our hearts, right? That homesickness. Like, this is great and all. And this is beautiful, but it's not home. It's not. And I just want to kind of go home and sleep in my own comfortable bed and see my family. I just want to go home. It's because home is home. It's where you live. It's where you like to be. And the text is saying right here, let the word of Christ be at home in you. It's not saying let the word of Christ vacation in you. The word of Christ should be living in us. It should be settling in us, staying in us as a home, dwelling in us. And not just dwelling, but dwelling richly. Dwelling richly. Richly here means a large amount, in abundance. So the word of Christ should not just be present in us, but overflowing in us. It's letting the word of Christ truly fill you up all the way till it's overflowing. If anyone were to cut you anywhere, you'd be bleeding Bible verses, right? That's how much it should be filling you up. It should be filling you up, dwelling in you richly. We cannot be content with just a spiritual snack once a week, twice a week. We have to stop being content with that. We need to truly feed on the word of Christ, to feed on it. And that means that we need to read it. That means we need to study it. And that means we need to live it. Those are the ways we can let the word of Christ dwell in us richly, is to read it, to study it, and to live it. I love that it goes on. There's an amazing parallel here in the later half of the verse. And the parallel is with the verse Ephesians 5, 18 through 21. The list is practically identical when it goes on to say the teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your heart to God. That's what it says here in Colossians. In Ephesians, it says to addressing one another. And then it goes on to say with singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness to God. It's almost exactly identical in the wording that it chooses to use. And there is a big difference between these two passages. Is in Ephesians, it's talking about the Spirit filling us up, right? It says, do not be drunk with wine, but be filled by the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. That's what Ephesians says. But here, it's saying that the word of Christ dwelling richly in us is what produces these things, the teaching, admonishing, singing. And so doesn't look like those two connect, right? One is being filled with the Spirit and it has this same list, and one is being filled with the word of Christ and it has this same list. Let me tell you, there is a pretty simple conclusion here, and it is that they're connected. These two verses harmonized together are connected. They're connected to one another. And it reveals this amazing truth. And if you have a pen, write this down, because this is an amazing truth from the word of God, is that a word-filled believer will be a Spirit-filled believer. A word-filled believer will be a Spirit-filled believer. That means as a person becomes more filled with the word, they will be consistently filled by the Spirit, which means to be empowered by or influenced by. And the more a person is filled with the Spirit, the more capacity they have to understand and obey the word of God. A word-filled believer will be a Spirit-filled believer. They're connected. They work together. I love God's word. Isn't it awesome? God's word is incredible. And how it connects things together to give us greater understanding and greater insight into not only the life of a believer, but the character of God. And I love this truth that a word-filled believer is also and will be a Spirit-filled believer, and how those two work together for our good. So good. So what happens when the word of Christ dwells in me richly? Well, I love application like this because it comes straight from the word. We don't have to like think about it or, oh man, what? I wonder how to apply this to my life. It's like, hey, here it is, found it for you. It's right in the scripture and we could see it together as we go through it. So what happens is that I am teaching, admonishing in all wisdom, singing psalms, singing hymns, and singing spiritual songs. When I let the word of Christ dwell in me richly, these are the things that flow forth from my life. These are the things that I'm empowered to do. These are the things that I'm able to do with the word of Christ dwelling in me. The first one is teaching. This is a positive, right? It's a positive. Do this and do that. It's instructing others on what the Bible says and how to live it out in our daily lives. It's the teaching of God's word. Admonishing is the negative. It's a warning, right? Don't do this, don't do that. It's a warning that if you continue in this behavior, if you continue doing the things that you're doing, God is going to discipline you. And these two things are to be done in all wisdom, the teaching and admonishing, done in all wisdom. Or another way to say it is with an exceptional endowment of discernment, insight, and understanding. What an amazing ministry that is open for us when we are filled with the Word of God. Amen? To be able to go out and teach and to warn people. But it's not done yet. It's not done yet. You're not just a walking, you know, Bible commentary. That's not the only thing. You're going to be singing. And so there's these two things. It's ministry and it's worship. We're going to be teaching and admonishing, but we're also going to be singing from our hearts to the Lord. It's worship. It's ministry and worship. And the first one it says is singing psalms. These are exactly what it says, the book of Psalms. They would sing the psalms. They would sing them out loud with melodies and with instruments. They would sing them. And these should be sung from our hearts and our mouths as we read through them. The next thing it mentions is singing hymns. A hymn is an expression of praise to God. It's an expression of praise to God. Now, I don't think that Paul was like specifically talking about hymns like Jesus Paid It All and Come Thou Fount. Mostly because those didn't exist then. But here's a fun fact. Are you ready? Here's a fun fact. The early church would have sung hymns from the New Testament scriptures. It's a fun fact. They would have sung the hymns from the New Testament scriptures. And I wrote a couple of them down. Historians and scholars have found some of these scriptures that they would have sung as hymnals in their services. And if you'd like to write these down, you can. I'm just going to go through them really fast. One of them is actually in the book that we're in. It's Colossians 1, 15 through 20. That's a hymn that they would sing in the early church. Another one is Philippians 2, 5 through 11. Another one is 1 Timothy 3, 16. Hebrews 1, 1 through 3. And 1 Peter 2, 21 through 25. And I think it would be a really great thing to go through those this week and to read those and to sing those they're all fantastic. I think that we should probably turn back to Colossians 1, 15 right now and we should read through it together and see what are the hymns that the early church would have been singing. And this is one of them. It's in chapter 1, verse 15. It starts with this. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in all things hold together. And in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. What a beautiful, beautiful hymnal. And I promise you all of the other ones are just like that. Beautiful truths and beautiful expressions of praise to God. And this is what the early church would sing as their hymnals. And then it goes on, the last thing that it mentions is singing spiritual songs. Singing spiritual songs. These are spontaneous songs from the heart. Now, I catch myself doing this sometimes, like as I'm driving home. I never do it in public because I have a terrible singing voice. You guys know, it's awful. And so I don't do this in public, but when I'm driving home, like after maybe I've listened to a song or I've started reading just an interesting piece of scripture that I've really just connected with, or just in a very grateful, thankful season, I just kind of spontaneously burst into song. And it's not really the lyrics of another song or really even scripture itself. It's probably some of that and probably mixed between, but it's a spontaneous song, and I'm usually singing about the goodness of God and how good he has been to me and to my family. And sometimes I'll sing about God's patience with me, thanking him for that, or God's great love and mercy towards me. Those are spiritual, spontaneous songs that rise up in our hearts, and maybe you've caught yourself doing that as well, and you just start singing about God. That's what this is. This is the singing spiritual songs, these spontaneous songs from the Spirit that come to our lips through our heart. And so when the word of Christ is dwelling in me richly, these are the things that are lived out in the life of the believer, teaching, admonishing, and singing. These are the things that are lived out. And so I need to let the peace of Christ, I need to be governed by the peace of Christ. I need to be grounded in the word of Christ. And then here's the third thing, be guided by the name of Christ. Look at verse 17 with me. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. I need to be guided by the name of Christ. Whatever I do, in word or deed, everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything. This is the capstone of this scripture. This is the simplifying everything down to a phrase. Everything you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus. Putting off the old ways, putting off sin, putting on Christ-likeness and forgiveness and love, and letting the peace of Christ rule in my heart, and letting the word of Christ dwell richly in me. All of it in the name of Jesus Christ. This is a yielding, this is a submission of a person's entire being to Jesus Christ. It's submission. Everything that I do in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And sadly, this is not the reality for a lot of people who call themselves believers. You see, we tend to compartmentalize and partition our life into pieces, right? Maybe you've done this, maybe you do this. We partition a home and school and work and family and friends and fun. And in those specific areas, we pick and choose the way that we behave and the words that we say. And we act and speak differently sometimes in every single one of those areas. We don't act and speak the same to the people at work as we do in our family and vice versa. Same with school, same with friends, same with church, same with fun. And now at face value, that's not really a bad thing, right? Like, of course, I don't talk to my coworkers the same way I talk to my wife. That would be weird, right? Amen? It would be weird. But what can so easily happen in that is not only does the content of speaking and acting change, which it should to a degree, but another thing that changes is, if it's allowed, is I allow these areas to distinguish between sacred and secular. I start picking and choosing. Well, church is a moment where I can be sacred, holy for the Lord. But in my family, I can be secular. In my work, I can be secular. With my friends, I can be secular. There's these two things at play, and I'm choosing each one of these in these areas, where I'm going to be sacred and where I'm going to be secular. In some parts of my life, maybe at church, I'm showing myself as humble. But at home, with my family, I'm self-centered and demanding. I can keep my mouth clean at church, but at work it's foul. I'm thoughtful and sincere with my small group, but with my friends I'm selfish and judgmental. This is hypocrisy, and it blasphemes the name of Jesus Christ, and it ruins our witness with other people. And the thing that I love so much about this verse is it destroys the dichotomy between sacred and secular. Because in the life of a believer, there is no such distinction. Everything is to be done in the name of Jesus Christ. There is no division. There is no partition. There is no compartmentalization. It is all to be done in the name of Jesus Christ. How I act and talk in my family, church, work, school, friends, fun, all of it needs to be done in the name of Jesus Christ. And the name of Jesus Christ is important. We don't think much of names in our culture anymore, unless you're naming a baby, which we are, and then it's really important, kind of the only things that we talk about, which we still don't have, and it's coming up soon. And we might have a baby girl with no name. Pray for us. But in our day, it's just a label that we use to call one another. But that was not true in the ancient times. Names were incredibly important. People's names, they could tell entire histories and heritages. They would be the characteristics of that person, the very identity of that person, who they were. It was all wrapped up in their name. And Jesus' name is incredibly important because in Jesus' name there is power, and in Jesus' name there is healing, and in Jesus' name and no other name is salvation. Jesus' name is incredibly important, and the early Christians knew that, and they knew that by identifying with Jesus' name and by identifying as Christians, as followers of the way or of Jesus Christ, they were staking everything on the power and reputation of the name of Jesus Christ. And so when we call ourselves Christians, when we call ourselves followers of Jesus Christ, we are confessing the readiness to be known in reference to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so because of that, because the name of Jesus is at stake in our lives, there can be no distinction in our lives. Everything we do must be done in the name of the Lord. Everything. I'm going to tell you something gross. Prepare yourself. Does anyone know what ringworm is? Raise your hand if you've ever... A surprising amount of people know what that is. Okay, so if you don't know what ringworm is, it is a skin disease, and it's not an actual worm, okay? It's like a fungus, which honestly, when you say that, it just sounds disgusting anyway. So, and it kind of forms itself into a ring, which is why it's called ringworm, on your skin. And so it's a skin disease, it's a fungus that grows on your skin. And so I, 2 weeks before I was to be married to my wife, I was working out, of course, right? Like, obviously. And I got ringworm. And it started like on my back, and I couldn't see it. And the thing about ringworm is that it is incredibly contagious, okay? Like super, super contagious. And two, it spreads like wildfire if you don't get it under control. So if you don't know about it, it goes everywhere. And so 2 weeks before my wedding, I'm not joking, it went everywhere. I had 152 spots on my body of ringworm. Now, if you know any, yeah, right. So I went to the doctor and I lifted up my shirt and he went, "Oh my God." He's like, "I've never seen ringworm this bad." And I'm like, "Doc, you gotta help me out. I'm getting married in 2 weeks. Like, this is awful. Like, something has to be done." And so he did. He helped me out. He gave me a topical cream to go directly on it, and then also an oral medicine that was just gonna help flush it out of my entire system. It was horrible. It looked like I had chicken pox, but they were all rings, and it was just everywhere, and it was starting to come up my neck and onto my face. And I'm like, "Lord, please. Please, like, let this be done." And so literally, I had to go through every single day, twice a day. I had to 152 times take the cream, put it on the thing. Dun, 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 dun. It took like a really long time. And grossly enough, I had my roommates help me because I can't reach my back, right? And you have to get every single one of them because if you miss one, it all starts over again. Just keep spreading and keep spreading. And no matter how much stuff you put on it, it doesn't help. It just keeps going. Praise the Lord. I got all of them. It was very meticulous. Got all the spots, totally fine by the wedding. It was just an act of the Lord, totally great. But that's how sin kind of is as well, isn't it? Number one, sin is disgusting. It's gross. It's ugly. It's sick. And two, sin grows. And if you allow any part of it to take foothold in your life in an area, it starts to spread and spread and spread and spread. And if we allow that to continue to happen in our lives, we see sin seeping into these different areas of our life. And so we have to be vigilant to do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I think a really good verse that kind of sums this whole thing up is Romans 13:14. "But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. That's what we've been talking about in Colossians 3. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Do everything in word and deed, everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So how do I do that? That seems like a pretty tall order, right? To do everything for the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, here's some helpful things. How do I do everything in his name? First, my motives for him. I need to examine the motives of my heart. What are the motives of my heart? Why am I doing, why am I acting, why am I thinking the way that I'm thinking, feeling, acting? What are the motives? What are my motives? Are they selfish? Are they self-centered? Or are my motives holy? Are they on the Lord? My mind on him. My mind on him. Meditating, thinking, studying, memorizing the word of God, the word of Christ, having it continually flowing through my mind. My mind is always on Christ. What does God's word say about this? What does God's word say about this situation and this problem in my life? How do I deal with it? What does God's word say? My mind is on him. My means in him. Coming to the reality that he is everything. He controls everything. He gives everything to me. I have not earned one thing. It has all been given by Jesus Christ to me. My means are in him. Everything that I have belongs to Jesus. Everything that I have belongs to him. My means are in him. My manner like him. My manner like him. Imitating Christ. Putting on Christ's likeness, right? Compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, forgiveness, and love. My manner is like him. I'm imitating Jesus Christ with my life, with my manner, with my actions. My mouth is about him. My mouth is about him. The way in which I speak, the conversations that I have with other people, it's about Jesus. And another one that's really like that is my message is him. My mouth is about him and my message is him. Preaching the gospel to people. My message is Jesus Christ. Why do I have things that I have? Why are things in my life going? Jesus Christ, my message is him. The gospel of Jesus Christ. He died and rose again. My mouth and my message is him and about him. That's how I can do everything in his name. And here's the last thing, and I'll close with this because my time is already gone. I've done it again. The last thing is this: be grateful in everything. Be grateful in everything. Notice that we've skipped, have you noticed? We've skipped a couple of verses. We've skipped a few. But notice that in every verse that we have read through here, every verse, it says to be thankful. Every single one, it says to be thankful. In verse 15, it says, be thankful. In verse 16, it says, with thankfulness in your heart to God. In verse 17, it says, give thanks to God the Father through him. Thankfulness, gratefulness. This is the help. Thankfulness. Do I want the peace of Christ in my heart? Thank you, Lord, for everything. Lord, thank you for always wanting to lead me to peace. Do I want the word of Christ to dwell richly in me? Thank the Lord for everything. Lord, thank you for your word, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to go and teach, admonish, and sing about you. Do I want to do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ? Thank the Lord for everything. Lord, thank you for all that you are doing in my life. And thank you that I get to call myself chosen by you and a follower of you. Thank you, Lord. The Christian life should be filled with thankfulness in our hearts to the Lord. Let's not forget that. Let's not move past that. Because even in the trying season, even in the hard season, even in the difficult season, and even in the good season, we are to be thankful. And that's pretty hard. But a great exercise of this is when you get into your car to go home today, just start thanking the Lord for everything in your life. Thank Him for everything. If you came alone, you can do it alone. If you came with your family, do it with your family. If you came with your friends, do that with your friends. Start listing the things that you are thankful for. Whether you perceive them as good or bad, thank the Lord for those things. Because it's going to do wonders in your walk with Christ. And letting the peace of Christ rule your hearts. And letting the word of Christ dwell in you richly. And in everything that you do, word or deed, be done in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thankfulness helps with all of that. Let us not forget thankfulness. Amen? Amen. Let's pray together. God, we are so thankful for your word, the instruction that it brings to our lives, the truth. God, you are so good to us. And the fact that you have given us your word to study and to read and to know more about you is what an incredible thing. Lord, would we take these truths? I pray for the person who is struggling with peace in their heart, where it feels like their heart is just full of chaos and in disarray and anxious and fearful. Lord, would you soften them to let the peace of Christ rule in their hearts? Lord, do that in my life. We need your peace. We need your peace to rule. Lord, let the word of Christ, let your word dwell in us richly, Lord. Remove all of the barriers that are keeping those things from happening and help us to invite that into our lives, to let these things happen. And Lord, would you help us? Lord, we need your strength in this area. That whatever we do in word or deed, that we would do it all in the name of Jesus Christ. And would we be grateful for everything? Because all has been given by you, Lord. And we are grateful for all of it. You are so, so good to us. And we worship your name and we lift high your name because your name is worthy. It is worthy of our action. It is worthy of our praise. It is so worthy. In your name there is power. In your name there is healing. In your name there is comfort. In your name there is peace. In your name there is salvation. In your name the stronghold of sin is broken. We love you. And we praise your glorious name. Help us, Lord, not to blaspheme that. Help us not to be hypocrites in this area. Help us, Lord, to do all in the glorious and wonderful name of Jesus Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name.